Good morning, everybody. It's the 8th of May 2016, and we're going on a little road trip today. So, once again, let's go.
Даже викат зад ните боли карам, викаме на мене ми се кара. Викам, айде ще пуснат се. Чува си твой година от както
го родина и половина по миналата седмица.
It's now highway. Slowly they were opening it at different sections. And you see that now, until we reach the mountain, we'll be all on the highway road. It's a very big project that they were building now for about, how much, maybe 6-7 years almost now. And since last year, they opened the last section. This area of the ring road that you see over here that we'll enter was finished just last year. Usually mid-March, conditions are very good for skiing. You know, last couple of years with the pollution, I can tell you they're getting less and less. Years ago, there were a lot more.
Another one.
Just there was no problem sure. To make a stop.
What's that waterfall called?
That one we call it the Devil's Waterfall. Mainly because it's very steep where it comes down. And the total height is about 75 meters on all the cascades. Those peaks that we see over there, they reach about 2,400, 2,500, approximately. Biggest, oldest, and most popular monastery complex in Bulgaria. At the peak of its power, just after the liberation, there were more than 400 people that were living here. About 300 monks, plus a lot of painters, a lot of teachers. It was a very big cultural center. Not only a spiritual center, but there was a school here. Some of the best painters were also living in these areas. And monastery complexes are really important for the Bulgarian history because inside them, during the time of the Ottoman Turks, was kept the national religion, the culture, the traditions, the language, everything which is typical for a nation. Ottomans again were ruling Bulgaria between 14th and 19th century. Many monastery complexes were destroyed back then. A number of them, you can read the stories that there was a fire that was started very often This was done by the local Ottoman authorities. They were destroying the monasteries. But very often, same like here, they were rebuilt again. And the very big fire over here was in 1833 that destroyed most of the buildings, most of the premises. This is why most of the church and the premises that we see today, they are from the middle of the 19th century, just before the liberation they are built. And this is a very typical structure for a Bulgarian monastery from medieval times. We call it fortress style because in the very center you have the main church that is located, and it is surrounded by buildings from all sides, so that in the evening they could lock the doors, so it's safer and more peaceful, just like that. These places were often attacked by smaller groups of soldiers living in the mountains. They were always trying to rob them. But big monasteries, like that one over here, used to have more than 40 guards, which were responsible only for guarding the place against thieves, against smaller armies. And this is why a number of the monasteries have their own defensive towers, that we call. The defense tower inside the yard of the monastery complex is the oldest structure preserved from the 14th century. We call it the Hrelo tower. Because it's mainly from stone, this is why the fire did not destroy it. It destroyed most of the other buildings, which were wooden, but the defense tower still stands, and from the 14th century, it's the oldest still operational structure located in the monastery yard.
So where is that?
Just next to the main church, you can see the stone structure. It's also still the highest structure in the monastery yard, not only the oldest one. 25 meters on the very top, it is just no more than 2 or 3 meters higher than the main cupola of the main church. Where you see the very small windows just on the last floor over there, they used to be a very small chapel, so that while monks were hiding inside there during wars, during dangerous times, they could also continue to pray just up there. And usually they were storing food for at least 2 weeks over there. And this was one of the very few Bulgarian monasteries that that the premises used to have up to 4 floors. Usually one, no more than 2 floors, but over here it used to be really, really big. And this was the first, actually, monastery complex in Bulgaria with 4 floors. In total, there were more than 400 rooms located in all these areas. In the past, awful. Today, there are no more than 50 people that are living over here constantly. The number of monks is 10 at the moment. Last 10-15 years, they keep this number, 10. Generally, the life of the monks is very, very difficult. They do have some candidates to become monks in the Rila Monastery, but usually just after living for a month and a half at the very most, they quit. Because it's a very difficult job, having to live in the mountain areas, very harsh life. And the last couple of years, most of the people, they simply don't survive the life and they quit after about a month. So only about 10 are the monks, but there are many people here living in the souvenir shops, maintaining the place into good condition, working in the kitchen. So that's why usually it's about 50 people today that are constantly living inside the monastery complex. UNESCO heritage site, this place since 1982, mainly because of the very highly decorated church with paintings inside, outside, more than 1,000 compositions located, but also the premises, they really keep the typical architecture of an Orthodox monastery in medieval times from 16th to 18th century. So it's UNESCO site, not only because of the church, but also because of the architecture of the place. As I told you, it was rebuilt in the middle of the 19th century, but they tried to rebuild the very same style that the monastery complex was looking like just before the fire. With all these wooden structures, with the very complicated decorative elements, number of terraces are located. And just to preserve everything in better condition, that's why they don't allow people to walk in the premises. only for the monks, for the people that live here. And there is a very small quarter part located in the monastery yard. Very basic conditions, of course. But just for about a day or two, it's possible for the visitors, for the guests, to sleep inside the monastery yard. Very quiet, very peaceful atmosphere it is. Just last year, I had the chance to sleep over here in the monastery yard. Believe me, it's really, really lovely. Very, very relaxing, very smooth, very clean air. Literally different picture compared with what we see with the noisy atmosphere during the day. And in the main church itself, there are more than 1,000 paintings being preserved. It's literally like an open Bible. Lots of scenes from the Gospels, from the Bible itself. Normally for the Orthodox people, we have loads of paintings inside the churches. Literally because many people could not read a couple of centuries ago, and by looking at the paintings, by looking at the frescoes, they get an idea of the Bible and they understand the Bible. That's why, typically for the Orthodox, not only in Bulgaria, we have a number of paintings inside the churches so that people can understand the religion just this way. And the place is definitely the most visited monastery complex in Bulgaria. In total, today we have about 100 of them that are preserved. As I told you, many of them were destroyed during the time of the Ottoman Turks, but still, about 100 are fully operational, and most of them also function as museums. Places preserved by the local government, and some of them, of course, they are nationally preserved. Rila Monastery is one of 9 UNESCO heritage site places located in Bulgaria. Taking photos in the outside gallery?
Yep.
Okay. I'm sure some of the compositions can be seen here. Usually close to the door of the churches, you see people going to hell. The idea is that when prayers enter the church, they are sort of respected or scared in a way. So that's why usually close to the door you see scenes of the apocalypse, of the last book of the Bible. Of course, some of the reasons for which these people were going to hell are really simple, really, really basic. Like, let's say you can see the devil over here is drinking from the wine that this person produced just over here. But a couple of centuries ago, literally the reasons were very basic, very simple, that the people were going to hell. A very popular image in our churches is the Archangel Michael over here. Usually it seems a little strange to the visitor that he's stepping on a person over here. He's stepping on a human body, which is a symbol of sin. By nature, the body is symbol of sin, but he's taking the soul of the person, which is pure.
Yeah.
So the soul itself will go to paradise, and Archangel Michael is taking it, but he's stepping on the body of the person, which is symbol of sin. This was done exactly by this really popular painter, Zachary Zograf. This is the scene of Last Judgment, or Judgment Day. We can see all people with halos just on that side. On the left, same for the Catholics, it's usually put paradise. Orthodox or Catholics, the person holding the key, it's always Saint Peter. We see first person in paradise, of course, Jesus Christ. All people having their halos, these are from the Old Testament. Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac. Rarely you see people from the Old Testament painted inside Orthodox monasteries. Usually we put more scenes from the New Testament, but especially in paradise, usually you see some scenes, some people from the Old Testament. And on different clouds are different groups of saints. Let's say we have warrior saints, we have lady saints, we have saints that are symbolic for particular countries, like just over here on the left. These are different groups of saints which are done on different clouds. So paradise we have on the left, with the river just on the other side. Different countries call it different way. We call it sticks, same like the Greeks. This is where all the souls are going towards hell. And it's always very interesting to mention that and to show that in the very center there is the scale of justice. All good things that you have done in your life put on the left, all bad that you have done being put on the right. And whichever side is heavier determines whether you're going to go paradise on the left or hell on the right. But what's really interesting is that usually you see some devils located just around this side trying to manipulate the whole judging process. You can see his hand just over here. He's trying to make that side heavier. Even the other devil is trying to pull his head, to pull his leg down, so that they make that side of the scale go down, so that they make it heavier, and the very pure looking lady goes to hell. So this is why the job of these two angels, just over here, is to push the two devils back to hell, so that they don't manipulate the whole judging process. The New Testament. Very rarely, only at some sections, you see some which are from the Old Testament. The Hrelo Tower, as I told you, named after after the local ruler called Hrelo, during which ruling the tower was built, middle of the 14th century, as I told you. Defensive towers, usually monks were hiding inside there during dangerous times. And as I told you, it's still the oldest structure which is preserved in the monastery yard since the 14th century, mainly because it's constructed out of stone. That's why the fire did not destroy it.
And we are over here now.
Oh, it's just in the museum, but you're not allowed to film in there. And you can't film in the church either. And here's a shot of the mountains. I've been given like 20, 25 minutes to myself just to walk around and do some filming. This is mountain water, fresh mountain water. I'm gonna try some. That's pretty good. They're doing some restoration work. As you can see, I imagine it goes on quite a bit in a place this size to keep it looking authentic. I'm just outside the other entrance of this place, and they've got a running river and souvenir shops. More mountain water for you. They actually have a donut shop out here. I'm gonna try one. These are what Bulgarian donuts look like. They're covered in sugar, can also be covered in chocolate, and I'm about to try one. They're pretty good. Well, I'm heading back to the other entrance to catch up with Boris and the driver, and we're going to lunch.
The whole variety of green color.
Yeah, and I ordered myself chicken soup. I've got some chicken wings coming too. Here are some really good looking chicken wings. I've had some in America that looked absolutely terrible. These ones were great. again.
Made just before the Second World War. The lady says it's no problem to have a look inside, so please.
Yeah, well.
It is big, as you will see. Some typical old signs from socialist regime. See, inside it's not only cars. Here, this section has loads of motorbikes, old televisions over here.
I remember old TVs, like that'd be like an 80s TV or something.
Yeah, but early 80s. That early one, let's 80s. Say, is maybe even 70s. I would say. Especially televisions, I can tell you what socialist times we were producing in Bulgaria. We had one city to the very north. He doesn't have out of them. Actually, this is produced in Sofia. I see the brand. It says Sofia over here. This company wasn't that big. We used to have another one located at a town called Veliko Trnovo, which was producing a lot more. This is also Bulgarian. Tsarevets, the whole brand of this is named after a very popular fortress. Located over there, used to be the old capital, otherwise the town was Veliko Trnovo that we were producing there. Yeah. These are colorful, by the way, these machines, I guess. These, of course, no color.
Motorbikes. I got an uncle of mine back home, he'd love this place, he'd like walk around here for hours.
These are also probably somewhere 60s, I would give a guess. These bikes.
Like, he buys like older cars and he like fixes them up and then sells them. And
these are really expensive, you know. Some people,
I imagine they are.
The old radios over here. Those on the top that you see also a Bulgarian brand.
These are железни тия телевизори. Old radios. Wow.
The bigger they are, the older they are, the bigger they are.
Typewriter.
Nobody's using those these days.
I remember this telephone. Everyone had a telephone like this in the old days. Yeah.
Once or twice I've seen on Bulgarian TV, they give such telephones to play to children which are like 4 or 5 years of age. They don't know what to do with it. They don't know that this is even a telephone.
Have we got a jukebox here?
Yeah, the jukebox, I haven't seen it before, last time I was coming. National Park Rila, work with proper tools, do not touch, dangerous for your life. Usually they put these at electricity places. do not turn on, machine broken. Do not turn on.
Do not.
This says forbidden for animals to eat the grass. Some of them are really funny, you know. please. Keep the animals away from the grass areas, let's say.
Here's one very old BMW.
And you can see the carts with only the two wheels over there. Гледаш. Боже и Мерцедес, да ще отвишим лемата колко готино пасва.
Да, да.
We are wondering, is it really a Mercedes or they put the emblem from another place? Това не е толкова става, това е 35 години може би.
Да, да, да. Ще на повече. Да,
на повече.
Сигурно, това съм виждал да е движение, значи.
Да, бе стига, това е сигурно на 5-6 години.
And we're heading back to Sofia. Well, I said farewell to Boris and the driver, and tonight's my last night in Sofia, and tomorrow night I'll be somewhere else. You'll have to wait and see where that is. Anyway, I've got to find something to eat. We got McDonald's across the road. Kentucky Fried Chicken, I think, is a walk down the street a bit. And we got Burger King right here. But I'm gonna keep looking, not sure what I want yet. They actually have a Dunkin' Donuts down here. That's amazing. I don't think I've seen Dunkin' outside of the USA. Well, I found KFC. I've eaten quite a lot of chicken lately, but the thing is, in Bulgaria, the most popular like meats are chicken and pork. Beef and fish aren't as popular. So I don't eat pork, so that's why I've been eating so much chicken. Well, here we have Bulgarian Kentucky Fried Chicken, and it comes with Coke, not Pepsi. Back in Australia, KFC used to have Coke a long time ago, then they switched to Pepsi because it's cheap and nasty to make. But anyway, these are actually spicy, apparently. You can't get spicy tender strips back home either. So these will be really nice. Anyway, okay, I'm going to eat now. What do you think you're doing? No food. Hey, I wouldn't. What do you think you're doing, bird? Go away. Away. He's coming back for another go. No. Oh, no, you don't. No. Go away. Go away. He doesn't get the message, does he? Go away. Well, everyone, I'm signing off for today. It's been a good day. And tomorrow we say goodbye to Bulgaria. And I'm going to say goodbye to you for today as well. So God bless you all. I'll catch you tomorrow.